Hello. Thank you. Discussion shortly. So we want to hear those good ideas. Delighted to hear the amount of exchange. But if we can collect them, that'd be great. We talked about Adam Smith, about dimensions of globalization. In Boschken, seven or eight dimensions, and we talked about Thomas Friedman, the world is flat idea. We then talked about top-down versus bottom-up aspects of globalization, Adam Smith being more bottom-up, Sassen and others often being Lenin, more top-down. And today we want to continue, especially on these readings of Sassen, Xing Zhang, and Jerome van der Waal, and then have a little more general discussion of that. Mainly as economic aspects of globalization and the way they fit in context. Okay. Maybe the simplest is to give you a very simple summary of some of the points of Sassen, which are the most controversial, in part because she writes in a very clear, apparently simple way, straightforward. She has very few footnotes. She does not cite Marx or Weber or Lenin or many of these other things. She puts them all together. I taught with her for several years, and that's the way she thinks and talks. She has a spontaneous creative style, and she puts things together in a way that some other people would say, "Why? This isn't my program," or whatever. So she's innovating in that way. But it's hard then, as a consequence, to sort of say, where does this fit and what are the limits or the context around which what she's saying? So let me have a couple of minutes before I get to this, actually. We tried given that her style is in the third reading today, Jerome van der Waal, Unraveling the Global City Debate, he's very critical, especially of Sassen, for confusing much of the discussion about globalization for decades. And he tries to clarify with specific propositions and showing their contradictions logically and empirically between different components of her own argument. Okay, we'll come back to that. But I'm flagging the importance of the Jerome van der Waal for the general point of logic in this field. And we try in the syllabus to help by building these propositions. So I'm gonna lead in with a couple of these. Bigger backgrounds from Smith, the world is flat idea from Friedman was pretty clear. The Marxist, okay, let's go to the Marxist tradition. The idea, it's in part in Marx, it's elaborated more especially in the essay by Lenin on, blocking on the title, it's a small book. And it basically stresses the world context, that is, you cannot have socialism until capitalism is eliminated throughout the world, because the capitalists will come back and attack the socialists, which has communism in progress. And therefore, world success of socialism is contingent on eliminating capitalism globally. And where and why is capitalism working globally? As capitalism in its more advanced stage develops, it tends to be more global. You have more global corporations. These corporate actors work together and they fight. They become more monopolies. As they become more monopolistic, they're more political, more hierarchical, and they try to suppress states and others around them. That's a simple version of the Leninist argument. That loose idea was used by people in the 1970s, 1980s, and it continues in many journalists and political debates. The Trump, Clinton, the Democratic primary, you heard a lot of debate along these lines. And Hillary Clinton got a lot of flack. refining it, or where and how you may make that more narrow, is it becomes more controversial. One person who was important in this regard was another guy named Friedman. This was John Friedman. He's a professor at University of Southern California, I think, in planning and architecture. He worked mostly on Latin America. And the Latin Americans tended then, at least, to see the world as world capitalism sort of crushing, holding down Latin America and its economy. So there were lots of political and journalistic students, professors who articulated these concerns, and he sort of distilled this. This in turn set the tone for lots of the globalization rhetoric. And it is picked up and used without reference in general by Saskia Sassen. She continues that style. She also grew up, she's Dutch. Her name Sassen is a Dutch name. She moved to Argentina. She lived there for a while, and she lived in Rome. She's a Dutch, but she's a Dutch Catholic in background. So she lived in Catholic Latin America and Catholic Italy, and then she was at Notre Dame. So she's got a very different view than most of the Protestant individualistic assumptions you have from Max Weber. Okay, so that style then came from John Friedman. He's on, I mean, you can read a little bit of his work if you want to get the flavor of this late capitalism kind of stuff. And the idea I've stated, global capitalism leads to larger markets, globalization in that sense, which leads to more monopolistic companies, versus then state socialism leads to state control of the economy. Both of these then are big national and global kinds of processes, not at all the bottom-up sorts of things. Okay, Sassen is not really a Marxist. I mean, she's eclectic, is my point. Another person in this regard was Robert Reich, who was in the Clinton administration. He was a laborer. He wrote a lot on labor. He's on the faculty at Harvard and in the Kennedy School for a bit. And he and Sassen both had a number of the same points. Some came earlier, some came later, and so forth. And they tried to improve a little bit on John Friedman, but they began to discuss new technologies and specific types of workers, rather than talking about the whole economy or the whole, say, of ownership, capitalist ownership versus proletarian workers. That is, Sassen has sections on middle managers. And on and her argument is middle managers should decline, and cities with many middle-sized cities with middle-sized corporations with middle-sized many middle managers will get smaller and lose out in this kind of competition as they're replaced by global corporations who contract out for many of the same services. And then, so she, and this in turn leads to her idea about which kinds of people benefit or lose. And she stresses a lot. I mean, that's sort of the Marxist, loose Marxist tradition. Who benefits? Who's really getting better off or worse off due to a movement in a global capitalist kind of direction? And her argument, what is her argument here? Let me ask, this is a leading question. I'll put the key point on the board and then ask how do we formulate this? General idea is that globalization leads to inequality. So this is Sassen. Okay, this is her most controversial formulation. It's the beginning of the Global Cities book. Yes. How does she make this argument? What are the drivers of this which fit with what we talked about on Monday? That's a hint.
She argues that the market will reward higher skilled workers, and so those with lower skills will like start to lose out on job opportunities, and then the inequality gap will continue to increase.
Yes. but with a big question mark. How is skilled defined? And just stick with your formulation, which is fine, but to make it work and to fit with this, you have to say, how is skill defined? That is, what you said might have been true in 1800 or 1850 or 1960. How do we make it specifically linked with this course and with the theme of globalization? And all of you should be asking yourselves this question. You all should, what does Sassen say and how do you think and talk about it? So everything you said sounds great, but it's not specifically global. How make it global? Okay, we got one hand almost. Anybody else? No hesitating hand? Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, so I think what she's trying to say is that with globalization, the cities, at least like North America, and like I think she used London, Tokyo, and New York, become like these centers of like service jobs and not manufacturing jobs, which are contracted out to like poorer countries. And so there becomes like this class divide where there are these very rich.
Okay, so stop. Is this coming from your guess or your reading?
From the reading.
Of Sassen?
Yeah.
Okay. Which specifics, okay, so fine as far as it goes, but if you think of New York, Manhattan, is she talking about all the service jobs in New York? No. Maybe I interrupted too soon. Which services are the key?
Like financial services.
Okay, here we go. Financial services are, okay, so, and why are financial services not just services or not just skill? That's what's different, which make financial services lead to this proposition.
Well, it requires like an informal labor market as well.
Okay, maybe, but that's not the key argument which he's making. Or elaborate a little bit more. How do the financial services fit into this? Why, that is, if you're a Wall Street worker, you work for a big Wall Street firm, Goldman Sachs, how does your working for Goldman Sachs lead to this happening specifically? Is it your smartness, your IQ? Is it your training at Harvard Business School? Is it the service, is it the financial service sector? What is it that Sassen, and as well as, let me give you another hint, Adam Smith also stressed. In this sense, this argument from Sassen is right out of Adam Smith. It's not from Marx, is the point I'm making. She doesn't tell you that, but I'm telling you that. So how does she draw in Adam Smith to make her most controversial Marxist, neo-Marxist point? Okay, yes.
Isn't the investment of capital, because like if you're in financial services, then you are direct and redirect funds to invest in like different places to create wealth?
Maybe, but she doesn't say that. In that case, I mean, if that were the argument, the driver in your argument here, and so I'm being specific because there's lots and lots of rhetoric and ideology about these points, and people often put them all together. The bourgeoisie, capitalism, skill, etc. I'm saying look at them separately and carefully and think about them, and your argument is really, or your term, your concept is really stressing capital and how capital works. I'm stressing, say, the person who is the employee in a big Wall Street firm like Goldman Sachs. And so I'm trying to say, how might they be part of this? Got a hand? Yeah.
Well, I think Adam Smith believes that, like, very simply that demand sort of translates like increased wages. So in a global economy, New York is supposed to be a high demand place for financial services. It makes sense that wages will also be higher.
Halfway yes, and well stated for a New Yorker. But if you're not a New Yorker, how is it even more true? Why is Wall Street important? Because of the location of Manhattan Island? No. It's because money's being invested in Wall Street from Toledo, Ohio, from New Orleans, from Hong Kong. It's a global center of finance. And people at Goldman Sachs do deals that include people from Hong Kong, South Africa, South Korea, etc. What am I telling you a story about, which in turn you can begin to codify? I'm playing Thomas Friedman here and telling you part of a story, and I'm asking you to make it into a proposition. Someone almost had a hand up. Yeah, Christina, is my head cut off, or how are we doing in our two cameras there?
It's good. Just I got a call and
okay.
Interrupted.
Okay. Yes, Stephanie.
I'm not sure. I feel like I'm missing the connection to Smith, because I'm kind of with you in that her argument seems to be that we're switching from the sense of like a firm had a place and a headquarters in that place, and it was tied to that place, and the headquarters might be in Arkansas where Walmart's headquarters are, or it might be in New York, and now we're switching to this model by which these high-end firms, financial services firms, but also maybe like high-end marketing firms or ad firms are focused in Wall Street, where they're also surrounded by like other firms where they contract out to, so accounting firms, consulting firms that do this other portion of the business. It's a new kind of center of business operations. We used to have like a manufacturing, GM is a better example than Walmart. It was in Detroit, and they would buy and move other factories and where they bought from to this place where they had a manufacturing center, and they ship from there, right? And now you have businesses in Wall Street, and you're getting these, they could theoretically be located anywhere, but they're getting these economies of scale from having all of their contracting services in the same place and face-to-face meeting operations. And then she also makes the argument that because these firms now have this globalized reach, they need more complex services to like fulfill all these functions in the same place. And inequality comes from the fact that like you need someone to like clean the floors in those buildings. So you have these really low paying service sector jobs and these really high paying service sector jobs all in the same place. And then Vanderwall says he thinks it's not how that happens. There's an alternative route, but that's her, I don't see
okay.
the connection to
okay,
like
no,
that.
No, stop. And that's great. I mean, you've given us a good, clear summary of her main points. The only thing you've not played up enough, I would say, is why do the high-end Wall Street people, the investment bankers and others at Goldman Sachs, get more high wages in her analysis? What drives their wages higher?
Skills.
That was the answer 15 minutes ago. What's different, I mean, they had skills 50 years ago, or 30 years ago, or 40 years ago. What's changed that she stresses, especially, let's say, after 1989? With the decline of the Berlin Wall, what happened? Russia, China, India became more open, and Latin Americans started lowering tariffs. Everybody started trading more with everybody else in the whole globe. In the back, yes. You stressed skill before. What's your name?
I'm Lauren.
Lauren, okay. Lauren.
Are you getting at the extent of the market?
There we go.
Okay.
That's the concept.
So
the extent of the market. Okay, let's join that explicitly with the Goldman guy.
Okay, so wait, the Goldman guy.
The Goldman Sachs employee who is now earning
okay.
more money. Why is he earning more money?
Because the profits are higher now. There's more people participating in the job that he, like more people are maybe investing in the product because there's higher yields, and so profits are higher for that.
No, but wait, slowly. More people are investing. Who are those more people? Where are they after, after 1989?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, they're in these expanding economies, like you just said, Russia, China, Latin America. So these Goldman Sachs bankers, I mean, they're providing, their customer base is much larger, they're providing service to more people.
That's the point. That's the simple point stated very clearly and simply. But behind it is, who could restate your point in Adam Smith's terms? Can you restate it in Adam Smith's terms? And basically, you did it with your phrase. What are your three words? Four words.
The extent of the market.
Okay, exactly. You reform, what your phrase said, the extent of the market has grown. Illustrated by China, India, Thailand, Argentina, Brazil, who in 1970 had more tariffs and had many things which said you may not trade with, in Korea. The Koreans 30 years ago said, we will not sell any Japanese products in Korea. We still hate those Japanese. They occupied us through a lot of the 20th century. We don't want them. Okay, that has changed. That is, that kind of thing has changed as there is more globalization, and globalization in Adam Smith's classic economic terms means the broader extent of the market. More people doing deals with one another. So everything that Stephanie told you about the face-to-face, the Manhattan proximity, all of that, yes, that's also in Sassen, but you're leaving out the critical driver of why do the salaries go up so much? That is, you can't hire a nanny and a chauffeur if you don't have more money. And why do you have more money? And the answer is Adam, it's not from Marx, it's from Adam Smith. Yeah.
But does she explain that? I mean, you could also imagine a Smithian world in which globalization doesn't have that, the polarization effect. You can imagine a Smithian world where wealth, like rising tide rises all boats. So does she explain why those gains in general wealth are accruing to the people in this highly specialized service firms?
That excellent follow-up question to what you said before, Liam. So let's go on to that now, because that's what she and others are now, and lots of people are fighting over, social scientists, ideologues, and so forth. So yes, let's keep the two parts separate. That is, inequality means some people get richer and some people are poorer. And you answered already about the poorer part, that the Wall Street bankers want to have chauffeurs, they want to have nannies and so forth, and therefore, how do they find, this relates to the question last time, how do we deal with migration in these models? How does she discuss this and have it, and how does migration play a role? The answer is the nannies and the chauffeurs tend to come from Latin America, the Caribbean, and they tend to be international, lower-income migrants. And they come to Manhattan, and they work for less. They don't work in a market of millions and millions of others. They tend to work in a more limited kind of market, and therefore they're paid less, is the kind of idea. Point one. But let's quickly add that she has three cities, and she argues in her, but I would say, she doesn't say this, but her argument, her conceptual argument is more, fits better New York. It fits less well Tokyo and London. So this is where we get to Jerome Vanderwalla. Let's flash forward and we'll come back. What does Jerome Vanderwalla, some of you looked a little bit at him, I gather, say about the, don't want to mix too many things here. We've got the extent of the market, we've got producer services, we've got migration as elements of this. Need a better. A little darker. I want to throw in immediately just one more piece here. There's a guy here who got a, come on, he deserves darker. There's a guy here got a Nobel Prize named Bob Lucas, L-U-C-A-S. What did he say about this stuff? Lucas said the opposite. How could he say the opposite? He's a Chicago Nobel Prize economist. And his basic argument was, as we have more competition and we have people coming from Mexico, working on Wall Street, earning money, what do they do with their money, which they earn from working as a chauffeur or as a computer programmer for Goldman Sachs? In the back, yeah.
They send remittances back to their home country.
Remittances, that's the key word. What's the largest component of the gross national product of Mexico and the Philippines? Is it services? Is it manufacturing? Is it IT? Is it nursing or whatever? No, it's remittances. That is the biggest driver of the whole economy of Mexico and of the Philippines, which, as you know, send lots of workers here, is that they send their money home. And when their money goes home, it gets spent at home, and that in turn raises the GNP of Mexico and the Philippines. So Lucas's argument is, as this happens more and more, we're gonna make the income, the whole economy, as well as the incomes of the brothers, the sisters, the aunts, the second cousins of those people who are getting the money sent back, is going to lead to less inequality. Okay, now let me, I tried to do it here once. I still can't do it very well. Christina, what's your secret? You picked up a beautiful black dark marker. Did you have any? If we find an expert in here, yeah. You just try them out. Maybe they're down there somewhere.
Yes.
I've used four, and all of them are just about worn out. There we go. Okay.
Green.
Okay. Let's use green. Okay. What I want to do now is I've shown you two opposite arguments. And I'm putting in green a box around them to say, how can we explain the disparity between these two? And is it maybe what's in green here? And what's in green? What we're going to call this is context. The context. And we have other terms as we go on. We talk about scenes, we talk about milieu, we talk about other things. But the idea is, or what another way is, in this case, to contrast with these two very simply, is what's the unit of analysis that Lucas is using and the unit of analysis that Sassen is using? Lucas is mostly using nations, and he's comparing Mexico and the Philippines and the total GNP of them with the total GNP of the U.S. He might get more specific, but the simple data that a lot of people use makes that same point. By contrast, what is Sassen using? City, yeah, exactly. Probably that's good enough, is to say the unit is the city. And it's one city, and then within the city, she's comparing income groups and say, is the size of the poor, is the poor sector going up and the high income sector going up? And her answer is yes. If the high income sector and the poor sector are growing in New York, at the same time that the middle income sector is getting smaller. Those people may move out of Manhattan, they may go to Brooklyn or Queens, or they may go to Florida, or they may go back to Mexico or rural places in Mississippi. Okay. So that's how migration is embedded, but it's not just migration per se, it's embedded in the specific argument, as you can see. Let me add, just in passing, and we'll talk about this as we proceed. Not in the reading list, but if you want to see a little bit more, take a look at the chapter in Sassen's book on consumption. Important title, consumption. And what does, in a word, has anybody looked at it? Or if not, I'll give you a word or two. What you say. Okay. Nobody's looked at it. Okay. Basically, her argument is the Goldman Sachs guy has to have a chauffeur and a nanny. He has to consume this way. He needs a big apartment on Fifth Avenue North because he's forced by his Wall Street surroundings to consume in that way. He does not have choice. That's a pretty strong, interesting statement. It's not Max Haven. Hint. Okay, so, but that assumption implicitly is what is part of the analysis here. That's how consumption works. That because you've got to have a nanny and a chauffeur and a big apartment and all that, then you're going to hire these low-income people as servants and the like, or providing low-income services, because that's the lifestyle which has to be lived. Okay, so I'd say part of the context in her analysis is an assumed consumption style, which is really forced onto the individual rather than chosen individualistically. Rather than saying some Wall Street bankers have red hair, they wear green hats, they may live in a rental unit because they like the neighborhood. She doesn't talk about that. or the young people. That is where you find the literature on this, which does. If you look at the young people who go to work for new jobs by young people in firms like, say, Accenture. Okay, I'm bringing in the firm, and this is an important part of her argument. Accenture is a classic example, like some of the banks, like some of the law firms, some of the accounting firms. What is it helping in this argument go further? And how's it making the general point that the two of you made with the extent of the market and the more people from India, China involved in this way? How do producer services contribute? Boy, Sasan, all that means that she has a crisp 15, 20 page section, which is that. Yeah, go ahead.
Me?
No, sorry, the young man, what's your name? I think you're in your hand up.
Me?
Yeah, was your hand up? Did I see your hand? Or?
I didn't, but I'm happy to like.
My eyes transposed. Okay, go ahead. Sorry. So you're Laura?
Lauren.
Lauren. Okay, Lauren.
I think Sasan was talking about how as firms get bigger and bigger, they start to outsource things that aren't like their core service, and so
yes.
That's where Accenture comes in.
Yes. But what's a producer service? Just to elaborate, just for the people that may not know that term.
Like what does a consulting firm do?
What's the definition of a producer service? Roughly. What's an example?
I'm not sure.
Anybody. You all should know this. Good item for an identification exam question. What is a producer service? It's a critical part of her argument here. A producer service does not sell a product to individual consumers like you and me. A producer service sells a service to producers like banks. So if I'm a big advertising company, I don't sell to you. I sell to the soap companies, the chewing gum companies, the finance companies, and they give me millions of dollars to write advertisements to say why Apple is better than Samsung and so forth. Okay, so producer services are big companies that sell to other big companies in a particular area like advertising or law. And why is this critical for globalization? Because producer services like a law firm will have, say, 500 lawyers, and they will say, if you're selling a product which you also want to sell in India, in China, in Thailand, we have lawyers in India and in Thailand, and they will figure out how to get around the laws or make the laws work so you can sell legally in Thailand and in India, and they will be able to buy your soap or buy your computer or buy this or that. Okay, that's why the producer service is a critical part of this, because the small local lawyer doesn't have the linkage to India or to China. And in a globalizing world, you need to have a knowledge and expertise to answer those kinds of locally based questions. So it's a critical part of the process, and the theory of Sasan fits pretty well. That is, you can say If you work for a local law firm, even if you have 100 people, 100 lawyers, you work in Chicago, and you know Cook County perfectly, and you have a second law firm, and it deals with India and Brazil and so forth, the hypothesis of Sossin is over the last 20, 30 years, the international law firm should lead to higher salaries for those lawyers, whereas the local law firm should not go up as much. Okay, and so her argument is producer services, especially these which are dealing more globally, will have higher salaries and more inequality in those cities with more of those people. And those tend to be more often, of course, where Manhattan, in her example, not Toledo, Ohio, not even Des Moines or whatever. Okay, so Lauren.
To be clear, so when she talks about specialized service firms, that's equivalent to producer services?
No. I mean, McDonald's in that sense is a specialized service firm, but it's not a producer service. You can be specialized in janitorial services or lawn care or whatever else. That's specialized and it's service.
But
producer services sells to producers, not to consumers.
Okay. Okay.
That's the key difference. And she uses it, but it's a standard economic concept. She didn't invent this concept at all, but she uses it in a critical way in her analysis, which is why I'm stressing it. Okay, yeah, in the back.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Would you say that consulting firms are more or less equally usable by, or salient with regards to Sossin's theory, considering that consultants travel and are typically part of a hub city, but travel to other places more so than people at law firms, depending on the type of practice?
Yeah, I mean, I would not say it's a question of me, but I would say, I think it's a classic question for Adam Smith. And what is the Adam Smith answer that Lauren just gave us earlier? I mean, how would Adam Smith answer his question?
Probably with regards to the extent of the market.
Exactly. That if you're in a consulting firm where you have a broader extent of the market, like a Chicago law firm that has services all over the world, those lawyers should earn more than the lawyers who just work in Cook County.
Okay.
That would fit Adam Smith. Okay. That is Adam Smith in the way that it is contextualized by subsector, by economic firm subsector, as we have done here. Okay? This is Reich. I mean, Reich did this more than Sossin, and Sossin picked it up for Mark. See, he was in the, I think he was Secretary of Labor under Bill Clinton, and he was concerned about different sectors earning, that incomes were going up and down and down and under. So he was concerned about, especially, say, manual labors in places like steel. And so the whole steel industry collapsed in Pittsburgh and Chicago. And people who were earning $150,000 a year suddenly were completely unemployed. I mean, thousands of them. Okay, so what happened to them? That's what Reich was concerned about. Similarly, if we look at the context here, city versus country, there also was in the, that is Jerome van der Waal, I had in his committee in Rotterdam, I was on his PhD committee, and there was a guy from England who was on his PhD committee from the University of London. He was the author of several papers, one of which is called Why Sossin is Wrong. And why is Sossin wrong in terms of London? He focused on detailed analysis of London and showing why Sossin was wrong because London was different from New York. And why? What was his basic argument here? And it fits with what you said, Stephanie. But you didn't specifically get there. So you had a little sojourn in England, you remember? Never heard of this discussion or debate, I guess. No. Okay. The point is, it's not a parochial discussion. It illustrates the same general point about the Chicago lawyer, the two law firms. Okay, the basic argument of his papers called, or one paper and then elaboration debate, because she was involved, a lot of people were fighting back and forth over this. basic argument is Sassen was wrong for London. That London did not have more inequality in this way. That this was more true in New York. There were a few people who were poor, but basically what he stresses is the British welfare state system protected low-income workers more than the American and New York welfare state. So, I mean, the way you can very simply show this is if you look at business cycles and you look at the U.S. or New York, it looks like that. You look at London, let's say in terms of Brexit, I'll just show it this way. So London may be more like that. And if we look at France, France is more like that. So this is France, England, New York, US. That is, the simple point is business cycles are more extreme if you have less government involvement. So okay. And so he makes the point that because London does not have these extremes of, so, and that is what I did not show was this generally going up. That is with globalization, they all go up. But the main point is, yes, the rich guys who are doing big deals in the area of London called the cities, the financial part of London, their incomes went way up because they were like the Wall Street bankers, even more so. It was a bigger center than New York, but it's being devastated now by Brexit is the question. But the second part of her argument failed in the sense that you did not have large numbers of foreign new immigrants coming to London taking low-income jobs to the degree that this happened in New York. Because the British immigration system is illustrated by the Brexit vote, they didn't want to let this happen so much. Second, people who were there, even if you're unemployed, there's a chapter in our book City Money on this, that is, even under Tony Blair, that is the British job creation, and that is why do these patterns differ? Why are they different? Where are economists in the crowd? And this is, again, this in terms of, you can see this is related to Adam Smith or the Adam Smith kinds of concerns. That is, Robert Reich was Secretary of Labor. He was very concerned about these kinds of issues, that the American worker was not being protected as well from the business cycles as was, say, the French worker. The corollary is, these are the old traditional French workers who have the jobs. If you're a new young French worker or would-be worker, and especially if you're North African, you come from Morocco, you live outside Paris, you try to get a job, you knock on the door, you fill out all the forms, they say, sorry, we're not hiring. That happens, this shows, much more often in France than it does in the US. London is in between. But if this is critical for Sassen's, that is that what you see here is the interpenetration of government with finance. These are not pure market processes. These are a combination of market with government. So insofar as the government guarantees or enforces certain right to work laws, the big issue is when you hire a new worker in France, you pay roughly twice as much as you do to hire a new worker in the U.S. So if you hire a new worker, say you're the same bank and you have a bank in Paris or a bank in New York, you may pay $50,000 to hire that person in New York. You may pay $100,000 to pay even if the net pay to the worker is identical. The difference is in the taxes. Their taxes, their unemployment benefits, their general government support advantages, subsidies, which help workers in general, but which reduce the net pay. Yeah, question, comment?
Just to add to that, I think it's interesting. In Sweden, it costs the same, we have the same, it tax the same on new workers and people who have been in the business for 20 years, which is very interesting because, I mean, as an employer, you would much rather
to someone who has experience and compared to someone who doesn't. So that's a big problem at the moment.
Okay. So what I learned a few years ago, I haven't heard the most recent numbers. Do we have? Is a PhD student here we go. Yeah, we have a PhD student from you're looking behind yourself. Don't look back, look at yourself. We have a PhD student in economics from Beijing.
Yes.
And my question to you is, if you're a worker in Shanghai or you're a worker in a small town, should you go to Beijing or Shanghai or London? And if you do, and an employer is potentially going to employ you in Beijing or in London, how much tax will they pay? That is, I give the example of $50,000 in New York, you may pay the worker, say $100,000 in New York, you may pay the worker $50,000 in Paris because more goes to tax. How about in Beijing? Beijing is a strong state government, but does it mean that the worker is paid less? Okay, so any way to quickly summarize that? That is, I know this comes as it's a new, fresh question to you, but.
Maybe it's the same wage.
A little louder?
It's the same wage as the New York.
Okay, that's approximately the right answer. That is, the big point is China is a strong state country, economy and government, but the Chinese economy works more like this. That is, the Chinese do not have the level and type of unemployment insurance, health benefits, retirement benefits as you do in Sweden or France. And in that sense, even though China is a strong state country, the benefits to the individual workers are less or equal than the U.S. And so compared to Europe, there are many more benefits for workers in Sweden than there are in China. Okay, so in that sense, don't think of China as having large welfare state benefits like Sweden. It's the opposite. China in that sense is lean and mean like the U.S. in terms of welfare state benefits. Okay. So the point of the Englishman of why Sassen is wrong is that she's assuming more of an American open market kind of context. But I'm going beyond, we're using initially names of countries like France to illustrate the simple basic propositions which are more general, which are in the syllabus. Okay, so I've given you the main controversial points, and you've gotten the key arguments from Sassen and the criticism of at least the Lucas. I'll just leave it that. I can fill in a few more boxes and hours if we want on the government parts, but I'll skip that for now and just get in these other two and make a lot more discussion. Okay, the next piece of this, we talked about China. We had a very smart student here from China named Xing Zhang. She worked with me and with Saskia Sassen. And she heard this discussion, and she heard Saskia Sassen's discussion, and she said, let me try to join these in a comparative analysis. And so what she did, and so she saw Sassen was really using New York City, one city, and building a big theory. Her evidence was limited. So what the student did was to take every metropolitan area in the entire United States, and she tried to test this proposition. And to measure globalization, I'll ask you, I'm sorry, I should try to use black here for in terms of color. How did she measure globalization? Anybody look at the paper and remember? Okay, globalization was immigration, foreign direct investment, FDI, that is money, capital investments from abroad. Am I blocking you, or is that okay?
Is that okay?
Okay. Okay. Don't worry about the other one. That's immigration, foreign direct investment, and producer services. And what did she find? And she measured inequality, sort of standard way, the proportion of people high, middle, and low income. I forget. I think she had a Gini coefficient, which is what the U.S. Census uses, sort of standard measures of these kinds of concepts. The difference, the original part of the MA was not to do this for New York, Tokyo, and London, but to do it for roughly 1,000 metropolitan areas. Then she also had as controls, say, education, race, unemployment, maybe education of the population, a couple of basic control variables like that, in addition to globalization, these three globalization measures. What did she find? She found a positive effect, as expected from Sossin, for immigration and for foreign direct investment. She found zero effect of producer services, no impact. Sossin was wrong. And we managed to have all three of our names on it when it was published. Saskia came along, even though she was fighting and screaming. All right. Okay, that was the very interesting bottom line of Xing Zhang. Let's go on to Jerome van der Waal, unveiling the global city debate. Very smart PhD, just a couple of chapters we have on here, really the first and the last. Okay, the first one basically says globalization is a messy field, I'm going to try to make it sharper. He tries to build propositions. We then had on the committee this discussion of it. So he has one, then he has a long section on producer services, which we're skipping over, but basically he went through the kinds of things that we have talked about right here. Then we get to his last chapter, which is quite original. What does he show there? Anybody glance at that? Okay. He brought in something new. The Netherlands is generally a very tolerant country. You don't get simple racial discrimination in politics the way you do openly, say, classically in France. I mean, at the National Front in France was openly racist. The Dutch are not that way. But nevertheless, there are variations between Amsterdam and Rotterdam and small towns and so forth. And so what he did was to say, okay, let's use all these same variables that Sossin and the others have used, but he merged lots of data. And he found some data from a survey which asked people, how do you like working with people who are from your city and who you know personally, or from the Netherlands, or from people who are from other countries and abroad? So he had a measure of workers working with other people from abroad. But the interesting part, and this is what's very unusual, because in terms of this global local politics, we love to have these kinds of data, that is city-specific measures of attitudes of individuals. But because these are so expensive, you only tend to get them very partially for 10 or so cities, or from a small country with a lot of money, like the Netherlands. Okay, so they do a lot of research and a lot of charitable contributions. And the bottom line was he had measures for workers in different cities in the same kinds of industries, banking, finance, accounting, and so forth. And he was able to see how important were the degree of willingness to work with people from abroad by city when you control several other variables. And what did he find? Producer services were insignificant, as Xing Zhang had found in the US cities. And so in that, again, Sossin was wrong. And what Sossin had really not talked about explicitly, that is, Sossin is making a very, in this book, she changed this in other books, but in this book she makes a very clear economic argument. If producer services have these kinds of characteristics, she does not talk about tolerance. Tolerance. He measured tolerance of working with people from international countries or not, and basically found that tolerance of working with people from other countries was very important, and it's suppressed. It was more important than producer services. Even in this generally very tolerant country. If he'd done the same thing in France or across the whole US or in other parts of the world, probably it would have been far more important. And this, in a sense, is what Christina's doing her PhD on, although she doesn't call it tolerance, she calls it cosmopolitanism. That is, are you interested and happy working with, and how much are you, you know, becoming more tolerant and subtle and cosmopolitan by virtue of going to different churches, having more churches around you, having more food around you, having more people from it. That is, so she's measuring the same kind of thing without a fancy, expensive survey. She's found smart ways of using detailed, service-specific, industry-specific data to capture some of these kinds of dimensions, which Jerome van der Waal measured with his attitudinal data. We do have data for at the county level where we have found similar kinds of things in the U.S., but not, we haven't done the same model as van der Waal. Okay, those are the key findings and bottom lines from this work. I could fill in, elaborate a lot of this, but let's have some discussion. We had a good discussion last time. Let's see if we carry on as we started last time, the beginning really today. You've seen some of the key works in this whole field, Marx, Adam Smith, Lenin, Sassen, and you've also seen people who've said, let's try to more precisely test how do they work. And some of them, as you've seen, were wrong. And so we had the field showing you clear progress from month to month. So this was what we're trying to hopefully do by adding China right now. And so we have many discussions. Does China work this way or not? And how can we get the right data to test whether these processes are different within China? You weren't here, were you here on Monday? No. See, Monday asked my question, which you've heard me before. Would you choose to work in a company that gives you a job that pays you a big salary in a small town in America, or a low salary in a big city? And we got the standard Chicago economic theory answer, and you're wondering if that's right or if that's different in China and why. So it's an illustration of how a PhD in progress is something that we could, yes, question.
So I was just a little bit confused about what the point was about tolerance. I don't really know the word of my question. What is the relation to tolerance, with the globalization argument? I was just a little bit confused.
Okay, no, sorry. I did go rapidly. I didn't state the finding clearly enough. That is, you tended to have more unemployed and less well-paid immigrant workers in those localities where tolerance was lower. So if you imagine a small town in the Netherlands, low tolerance, the Dutch would almost never say this openly, no, I don't like working with foreigners. But if they somehow say, I would rather work with a Dutchman than with someone who's foreign, that would imply that there would be fewer jobs and fewer promotions and lower salaries for foreigners than available for Dutch. And that's basically the kind of thing that he found. Yes?
And so, how does this disagree with the assessment?
Okay, that good point. I mean, good question for all of you. How does this disagree with Sassen? Yes?
Was the argument that the cultural tolerance variable is more or at least as important as the other variables? Because, I mean,
yes, that's the key answer right there. Go on.
Because when he brought the term cultural capital, and he said that that was what the lower educated natives lacked rather than lacking economic capital. I wasn't completely sure what you meant by cultural capital. Because he he defined cultural capital very quickly as just understanding the culture, and I guess, but that's kind of just repeating.
I mean, you're good to raise it. I mean, the term is loosely used by many people. So I'd say, in general, you need to look more closely and see what he meant specifically in his work. I won't try to answer for. If anybody can find a page in Jerome Vanderwall's text, we can look for it. But maybe look for it and see if you can find his definition, and then we can go over it. But yes, is the point made clearly now? If anybody else want to ask us to elaborate more, let's have a different example. Let's say a U.S. example where this might hold. Imagine we have banks. We have banks in the entire United States, in every single zip code. So Christina's got measures of, maybe I should even let you set it up. Do you want to frame something you have an actual finding on that would be a test of local cultural tolerance and how it might differ, say, between the South and the rest?
I haven't done that yet, no.
But here's a simple way. So she's measured, how have you measured, say, cosmopolitanism in simple way in some of your work?
Well, I want to create like an index with diversity of restaurants and religions and arts and see how they combined with ethnic diversity in a location can reflect how much a place is more or less diverse than others.
Okay, so great. So let's assume we have her data and we've created measures of diversity in restaurants and in these things, and we do this for every zip code and every, all the local units in the whole U.S. She's got 45,000 roughly, not with all the data, it gets cut back if we add more variables. Basically, big N, lots of units. And we can get this across the whole U.S., including the South. And we have not just this kind of diversity, but we have the classic measure which comes from the feudal order. Before the U.S. was created, there were differences among different social groups in Africa and in Europe, and they included slaves. Okay, slaves weren't paid. They were bought and sold, and they were treated differently because you'd buy a slave and you owned the person, either for life or in terms of England at the time, they were called indentured servants. And they were indentured for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, depending on what crime they had committed. Okay, and then after the American War of Independence with the English, the Americans no longer would let the English ship their criminals to Boston, or not, I shouldn't say Boston. North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, and so forth. And so the English, in turn, shipped their criminals to Australia, and the Americans engaged in the slave trade. So they brought Africans directly from Africa to the U.S. And so you then had, obviously, I'm giving you history you all know, but basically I'm saying this is a feudal pattern. But even today, when we have cosmopolitan views among people at the USC and PhDs, we don't want to forget the feudal cleavage in the American, that was classically in the American South. So if we set up a model with her measures of tolerance, and we also include race, say percentage of African Americans in at the zip code level, but then second, we use the traditional region, say by state or by county of the American South, then the question is, if we frame this kind of thing here in a way that fits the Jerome Vanderwaller idea, would we expect inequality of income within banks in the entire U.S. to be larger, the same, or equal within those areas of the U.S. that today or traditionally had more African Americans? That is, would the disparity between African Americans and whites be larger in the South, the same, or no different? Hypothesis. I'm not saying. Yeah, what would your hypothesis be based on this background?
Well,
simple. I mean, it's a simple idea. I mean, it's not, I'm trying to lay it out in a way that doesn't, it doesn't sound ideological, but more historic. Nobody's raising a hand. The answer is obvious. All of you know the answer to my simple question here. Yes.
Yeah, based on the Van der Waal argument, there should be more inequality in the South since
Okay. Yes. Okay. And there does in fact happen to be a study which has done this, and that's what it finds. Okay. It's not, he doesn't have Van der Waal's methods, but it's not exactly the same, but it's the same idea that inequality based on race tends to be larger in those areas with traditional higher, and you see that in part with people arguing about all this stuff with Trump, and who supports Trump, and where and how might inequality increase with immigration. See, so in that sense, Trump has crystallized some of these variables. Most of this discussion, you know, is politicized, argumentative, and so forth. But some of these ideas are stuff which has been studied by social science. It's more thoughtful. Okay, so even if it's hot politically, doesn't mean that you never should talk about it. This is the USC. You're free to think whatever you want. Don't have to write about it or shout about it, put it on a placard, but think about anything you want. And think even non-politically correct stuff. Okay, other thoughts, questions? Let me ask a somewhat related question. There, and this is for our two PhD students in sociology, and for the rest you can learn. There's a Chicago. It was the largest Chicago foundation until recently, at least. The MacArthur Foundation has what they call a genius award. The MacArthur Foundation Geniuses. And last year, they gave the first award to a University of Chicago sociology PhD who had recently gotten a PhD here. Who was he, and what was his award for, and how does it relate to this discussion? He's a Muslim student. He was a student who worked with me and with Saskia Sassen. And he worked in black neighborhoods, working on trying to get the black gangs to become more Muslim.
Is he from the book that
Which book?
Freaking
Out. No. I mean, he's not. Maybe there's something. Yeah. Let me think back. No. I mean, the main PhD student in Freakonomics is not this guy. No. But he is another. Did he work with Saskia? No, I don't think he did. He worked with me and Bill Wilson. So I work with both of the students, he worked on really on gangs, selling drugs within the public housing buildings, and who is in favor of tearing down public housing, and because he worked as a gang member, enough close to them, he there was a lot of material which is used in the Freakonomics book. I think that's what you're talking about. Yeah. I'm bad on names as you can hear, but I can tell you lots of stories about these, but I come up with the names as needed. Anyway, take a look if you want, and yeah, maybe even on now, just Google the second guy is on the faculty now at the Chicago Theological Seminary. I think that's it. CT is it. It's right next to the USC books, USC Press building. And I ran into it in a bike shop about 3 months ago, and so actually I wanted to, we may even be able to get him to come to this class, because he's funny, he has a great sense of humor, he's always cool, he's got the black cool swinging style, and these square young ladies that Saskia mostly work with, oh, you're telling jokes about these important things, don't tell jokes about that. So anyway, he pushed on. He did a great PhD. He's, and he's I'm proud of him for getting that award. And when it was announced in the sociology department meeting, not a single faculty member had ever heard of him. I was amazed. Okay, except for me. All right, so that shows the segmentation, unfortunately, among our talented students. He got his award, no doubt, for a mixture of social action and his ideas. And so I'm not saying it's just the quality of the ideas. He also is an important social activist in Chicago, and obviously this fits with it's an anti-Trump statement and so forth by the time of But anyway, good stuff. We have a few more minutes. We could ask our two teaching assistants if you want to add anything, either a comment, a question, observation. Yeah, we're asking, please, if you didn't see the syllabus, if you have a cough, we sent away one of our three teaching assistants at the beginning of class today. She couldn't talk. We said, if you're that sick, please stay in bed. Okay. So in the future, we'll ask anybody with a cough, please use the YouTube. But you two folks, any thoughts? We've elaborated a little bit of cosmopolitanism, but anything on China?
Bit,
yes.
Just a bit like elaboration on what you talked about earlier about like why people like in China migrate to the larger cities, and in certain instances, why in certain circumstances they don't. So I think there's certain argument we talk about here is certainly would, like in bigger city we have better entertainment, more resources, more talented people. But in another way, it's like in China's case, the people migrate to Beijing, Shanghai, Hong Kong, enjoy all these benefits, but at the same time, there's like huge cost for them in terms of the housing prices. That's a downside of it. So people trying to balance all the benefits they can got from big cities, but still they are kind of think about the housing price there. So a lot of people nowadays, they are trying to migrate back to their own hometown. So if 10 years ago, people are talking about like concentrating in large cities like Shanghai, Beijing, but nowadays people are just fleeing back to their hometowns. But there's another issue going on there because of all the incomplete infrastructures there. So all the difficult for the inequality between larger cities and smaller cities in terms of resources. So it's kind of interesting to see it because of the importance of the housing prices, which may be partly due to the globalization of capitals.
For about 20 years, I've tried to have at least once a year to have a Chinese teaching assistant, and then at the end of each class to ask, might any of what I have reviewed from these mainly Western theories change if we took it to China? So do you see anything here? And you're commenting in general, but anything specific in this that we might want to change? I mean, in a sense, I put France in here, and I suggested China might be more or less similar to France. But anything else you want to add that might fit with what we discussed? That would and we have. How many of you are from China? I mean, one, two, at least two. Be two, one, two, three, four. Okay, five. I said four. Okay. How might any of this change for China? And then why? Why is China different if it is different? I think all your comments are excellent in the sense of stressing the amenities have attracted traditionally people in the last 20, 30 years from the rural areas of China to the big, especially Beijing, Shanghai. But the housing costs have gotten astronomical in those cities, especially for young people, low income, new people, and especially people who do not have official residence permits and who are legally rural residents. So they don't have the rights to certain hospitals and so forth that the Beijing residents do. Okay, so there's a famous bestseller in China called The Ant Tribe, illustrating this, which is about the tribe of ants of thousands of people who live 2 hours from the center of downtown Beijing and who travel 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours at night on the subway to get back to their home as they work in the downtown area. And these are university graduates who are apparently smart people, but they don't have good jobs, and they tend to live in dormitories with 20, 30 people in a room, you know, bunks and so forth, dirty. And so it's an expose book about it, but then it became a bestseller, and the author came here to Chicago. He spent 3 months. That is, the political leadership in China was sympathetic and said, yes, this is a problem. They gave him lots of money. He then did surveys of students, of young workers in, I think, 20 Chinese cities. So he had the data. It's like your PhD. He was a young scholar. I think he was a lawyer, however, so he had no training in social science. Wrote a great book, but he didn't know how to analyze it. He got a lot of money, collected lots of data. Then he came to Chicago and said, how can I analyze the data? Okay, just like your PhD. But I mean, he had an argument. He had a good, clear argument. But what was important and what was valuable was that he collected the data not just in Beijing and Shanghai, but also in many other cities, so he could compare across the cities. Okay, what hypotheses might we have from you two, at least, about other cities in China?
Okay, so one thing I'm thinking about is, like, in terms of the low-income immigrants. So in New York, we can see a flushing of this kind of population to fill in the, as Saskia Sassen said, so we have inequality.
Exactly.
But in China, this part of, I mean, in big cities, because of the high housing prices, this population kind of going back, so maybe it does not exist anymore. I'm talking about Beijing right now. So in the past, they have like ant people, as you talked about, like 10 years ago. People can still go into Beijing and find somewhere to live, affordable place to live, and somewhere very like far away from the city center. But nowadays, the government is doing all the cleaning up things in Beijing right now. So everything like low income regions are being cleaned up by the government. So everybody just, they are get rid of people. In terms of low-income people from
in the
Beijing.
U.S., they would call the government is gentrifying the big cities. Okay.
Yeah. Or like an eviction story of China version. So we are missing this kind of low-income people here. So the inequality issue become different in China's case. So maybe it become more radical, you know, way because few of them exist anymore, and maybe they become more low-end in a way, or the income gap is lessened because of the most low-end people are just left out, and so we got people from the middle class, only the middle class, but no low-end people. The people can provide like cleaning services and restaurant, cheap restaurant services in the city. So maybe yeah, two hypotheses.
Okay, I mean that's very good and specific, and then it would be good also given the kind of data that we have here, because it should vary by city. It should be more true in Beijing and less true in a middle-sized city, perhaps. So you would expect maybe over time that there may have been more inequality in Beijing 10 or 20 years ago, but it may have decreased following these kinds of discussions. But maybe it has, would you expect that it would increase in a middle-sized Chinese city, perhaps? I don't know.
Yeah, I think because of in middle scale city, the scenario is different because of the high end people's money salary is not as high as those in Beijing. So the higher bar is a little bit lower, yeah. And the lower bar is still lower. So it's not sure. I'm not sure at this point.
Okay.
For me.
Okay, but what I'm pointing out is the power of having a clear, specific theory. Then you can say, does it work in New York? Yes, it seems to. Does it work in London? No. Does it work in the Netherlands? Partially, yes, partially, no. And then does it work maybe in Beijing to some extent, but not so much, but that is, we can see and then try to say why with the kinds of variables which are here. Okay, end of class for today. We can meet, normally we have office hours Monday, but I can stay a little bit if you have questions, and especially if you have formal assignments.